world, Dan Brown here with another episode of WOMBOSTORM! Yeah, that's right. It's a show about Commander, and I'm wearing a witch's hat. Not just because it's October. I always wear a witch's hat in WOMBOSTORM. You must be new here. Moving right along. Last week, I helped someone named Ham with a Tiana Ship's Caretaker deck. But before I even sat down to record the episode, I put a lot of work into building the deck that I was going to feature. And I emailed the decklist their way just to see what they thought, if they had any last-minute feedback. And they got back to me, and they're like, oh, hey, I really appreciate you doing this, but I was really hoping you'd run with the whole prison stack strategy thing that I kind of touched on, but also didn't make the sole focus of my email, so it gave me plausible deniability to not go with the strategy that I'm not as well versed in, etc., etc. I digress. So I didn't have time to change the deck that I built for them into a prison stack strategy sort of thing, but because in making YouTube content about Commander, my goal here is to both get better at making content and to get better at my favorite game in the whole universe, EDH, Elder Dragon Highlander Commander. I need to push myself, okay? I didn't choose the prison strategy because I am personally not that good at them. I've never really pursued them. I don't know that much about them, and I want to do right by Ham, so I this week, the follow-up episode is about that. I ask you guys in that episode to leave a comment with a cool nugget nucleus of an idea for a prison-style deck, and Tim said, how about Darigaaz Reincarnated as a recurring bomb with a prison stack style strategy to support it? There are a few old Jund cards like Destructive Flow and Earthlink that are untapped in terms of potential as an example of applying pressure. Well, they're untapped in terms of potential and also untapped most of the time they're on the board because they're enchantments. Here they are. First of all, in the middle, Darigaaz Reincarnated costs 7 mana, Jund colors, legendary creature as they all are, dragon, as many of them are, 7/7 flying, trample, haste. That's the easy stuff. Harder stuff is that anytime he dies, instead you exile him and put 3 counters, they're egg counters, on him. And then at the beginning of each of your turns, you remove one of those egg counters, and if it was the last egg counter, it just comes right back. Don't even have to pay the mana cost or anything, which is pretty interesting for a Stax strategy. We'll get into that in a minute. But it basically means you just have to cast Darigaaz once, and then if you're locking down your opponent's resources, you don't really care if it takes 3 turns for him to come back anytime he dies, because first of all, not going to die that often, but also, like, if your opponents don't have any resources, they're not doing that much with those 3 turns, right? You kind of get to time walk, time walk, time walk. Oops, I have a dragon. Anyway, other cards that Tim was talking about, Destructive Flow on the left, 3 mana Jund enchantment that plays really well into any stack strategy. Well, not any stack strategy, but certain stack strategies. At the beginning of everyone's upkeep, they sacrifice a non-basic land, and then on the right, we have a 6 mana enchantment with an upkeep cost of 2. Whenever a creature is put into a graveyard from play, that creature's controller sacrifices a land. Okay, interesting starting point for a deck. Calling this I'm proud of this name. This deck is Darigaaz Ruins the Game, because that's what Stax decks do. I don't really feel that way. A little. Stax is the most controversial archetype, I believe, in our favorite format of Magic the Gathering, because the whole plan is to prevent players from being able to fully play their decks, right? If you deny people resources, then instead of tapping lands and casting spells, they're mostly just passing turn and watching you play if all things are going according to plan. However, breaking out of Stax locks is certainly possible, and it can be very, very interesting. Stax decks are incredibly skill testing to pilot, and if you identify a player as a threat in any pod early enough and work together with your fellow non-archenemy players, it can be dealt with. Like, there is a time and a place for Stax. The only thing that I will say is kind of a hard and fast rule is you should never only bring a Stax deck. Okay, you can play Stax your first game, but if you win and it's kind of oppressive and unfun, maybe pull out your Feldegriff deck next. Just a thought. Next slide. So, because I don't have much experience playing Stax, I've never really looked into it that much. I only know, I've absorbed through osmosis what it means, and I've played against those, these decks a few times, although my playgroups normally are more combo-oriented, control-oriented, a little more traditional. I pulled up a primer that was written in 2013, I guess, on MTG Salvation, but it was pretty informative. I read through it. There's a link to it in the description if you want to check it out, but many top stack strategies, according to this primer, exist in white and blue, which happen to be the two colors that we are not running in our Jund Darigaaz deck. So I skimmed the article for elements of stack strategies that seemed most relevant to the colors that we're in, green, black, red. And what I came up with is, well, first of all, mass land destruction really jumped out. Like, blue-white stacks decks seem to be more about locking down the game as early as possible, where when you don't have access to those white and blue effects, it might be better to let the game develop as normal through the early game, and then sometime, you know, in the middle, cast some mass land destruction effects, some huge board wipe that resets everything, and then try to lock down the board. I think this plays a little bit more to Jund's strengths, particularly red as a color. Its strengths, it's, you're pretty good at blowing up all of the lands ever. Just wait for a critical moment and then lock down people's resources. I have five mass land destruction effects, which, you know, isn't enough to organically draw them every single game, but we also run many tutors in the deck, and one of the most common things we'll be tutoring for is land destruction. So we got five of these in the deck that I built. And also, hopefully, by the time you cast some mass land destruction effect, you will have already put Darigaaz in play, because it does cost seven, right? Not that common for Stax decks to have a commander with such a high CMC, but we're doing it just a little bit different. Cast Darigaaz first after a pretty normal early to mid game, then wipe everyone's resources. Even if your mass land destruction effect kills creatures, we don't really care that much, because Darigaaz will come back in three turns regardless. Okay, then this is what the Stax primer on MTG Salvation referred to as the universal package, right? Colorless Stax effects that go in basically every Stax deck. I have 10 of these effects. Smokestack, obviously, the namesake for the strategy. Beginning of your upkeep, put a counter on it. And then at the beginning of each player's upkeep, they sacrifice a permanent for every one of those soot counters. So if you do that right after some brutal wipe, if you have a few mana rocks or mana dorks left over after killing everyone's lands, you can run things that generate tokens, for example, get to that in a second, and sacrifice those tokens every turn instead of your lands, for example, that your opponents are going to be stuck sacrificing instead. Tangle Wire, very good for locking down the board. Static Orb, Winter Orb. If you want to pause the video right now and really read through these cards, if you're not familiar, might be useful, but you begin to understand what we're trying to do after blowing up everyone's lands. Okay. We're also including this suite of five, I'm calling them Stax lands. Okay, I have 38 total lands in the deck, but these are five of them. They're just very, very useful. It costs no mana to play land, obviously, in further locking down any opponent's post-mass land destruction. If you know someone starts maybe having enough mana to develop a little bit of agency, being able to tap it down with a Rishadin Port seems pretty good. Or maybe Wasteland away one of their lands. Seems good. There's just a lot of ways that they can be good. Also, Destructive Flow plays really well into our universal package side of the stack strategy we are employing. It's not universal, obviously, because it's in three very specific colors, but it does, you know, kind of, it does a similar thing to Smokestack, right? We can be disproportionately prepared for a board state where people are having to sacrifice a bunch of lands. Destructive Flow has the green check mark. Earthlink, I'm not running it. I decided not to run with that part of the prompt just because six mana is a lot. Stax decks want to have a really low to the ground curve, part of what prepares them better than other players for a situation where, you know, lands are wiped once or twice over the course of a game. And the upkeep cost, you know, also it can be a liability post mass land destruction. Creature put into a graveyard causing its controller to sacrifice a land element of Earthlink just doesn't synergize quite as well with the direction that I wound up taking this Darigaaz deck in. I decided not to focus too heavily on creature destruction, right? Like I was saying, the low curve. Here's a screenshot from the primer on MTG Salvation. Important for Stax to have a low curve. Earthling is just doesn't, you know, it's just not, it's, yeah, it's, bleh, 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 bleh. And because we are running a token sub-theme. Earthlink really kind of is an anti-synergy with that. If an opponent somehow destroys many of our tokens, gives all of our creatures -1/-1, for example, then we have to sacrifice all of our lands, and that would not be a great thing. Major nonbo, as they say. Anyway, I've been talking about the token sub-theme. Here it is. Also mentioned in the Stax Primer on MTG Salvation is that tokens can be a good way to make sure you're better prepared once you cast that smokestack. I'm running 10 ways to churn out tokens turn after turn after turn. Heavy premium, not just on token generation effects, but on token generation effects that don't require any additional resources to make those tokens once they have already been cast, right? Like Bitter Blossom, Goblin Rabble Master, Awakening Zone, they automatically make tokens once you've paid 2 mana or 3 mana. And then Parallel Lives is just very good if you can get any token generation, particularly if you can get multiple forms of token generation onto the battlefield, can really, ultimately be how you wind up winning a game, grinding out some sort of an advantage post-Stax lock. Okay. Yeah, here's Smokestack. Yeah, we are potentially able to lock down the board if we have just token generation turn after turn, right? If we have a way to make 4 tokens every turn, like Parallel Lives and then 2 token generators, for example, then if we have 4 counters on Smokestack, we'll just sack those tokens every turn, where our opponents, like I've said before, will have to sacrifice ultimately everything they have. And then we just win by default eventually. My deck also has 8 what I call lands matter effects. Again, because we expect all of the lands in the deck or on the board to be blown up at least once every game, it makes sense that we would be able to bring those lands back from the graveyard with like Crucible of Worlds or Ramanop Excavator or Splendid Reclamation or Life from the Loam. Titania is really great value before you cast the board wipe. If you get her out with 7 lands and then destroy everyone's lands, I mean, you can knock out an opponent or two just, you know, from Titania tokens alone. And then Exploration, Azusa, Oracle of Moldiah, I mean, they're good cards in the abstract. If you just draw them early game, they can help you blast off to a faster start. Or couple that with Crucible of Worlds, Ramanop Excavator, they can enable you to rebuild your board position very, very quickly as compared to opponents who maybe didn't see a mass land destruction effect coming. Next slide, we also have 3 miscellaneous value cards. Seedborn Muse and Sword of Feast and Famine are excellent once you have some of that universal package online post-board wipe. You know, if you have ways to prevent lands from untapping for all players, having your own personal way to untap your personal lands can be a way to break out of your own lock in a way. Better prepared for that board state. And then Scroll Rack, I don't know, just generic good stuff that I don't quite consider card draw. So it has to go in this category. Category. 1 of 3 effects. I have 10 ramp effects. They're mostly mana dorks, which is a little less common for many Stax decks, but in Jund colors, it just seems to make sense. There's a premium in Stax, in prison decks, on having alternative mana sources so that when you cast some mass land destruction effect, or if your lands just aren't untapping because of some sort of orb or wire, these guys can untap and you still get you there mana-wise. And Elves of Deep Shadow is just so darn cool. 1 mana dork that taps for a different color than the color that it is. Pretty neat. 10, it might be a little bit light for the number of ramp effects. Like I do not, after dedicating, you know, 1 week towards building a prison deck, I do not consider myself even remotely an expert on this particular strategy. So I am eager for your feedback. This is like a, you know, second or third pass at the deck. But one of the things that I'm most curious about is, should I be making cuts to make room for more ramp than this? I don't know. Tough call, because many of those lands matter effects are kind of sort of ramp effects in their own right if you draw them in the early game. Like Exploration could maybe count towards this. I'm not including it here, but curious for your feedback. Leave a comment below. I also have 5 draw effects, which is far fewer than in most decks. Skull Clamp, just a representative example, especially with all those tokens. But 6 tutors help to make up for the lack of consistent draw. We're often in need of very specific cards in here. So if we get, you know, 1 or 2 tutors for 1 mass land destruction effect and 1 universal package Stax effect, that can often be enough to generate a very, very big advantage in a game. I assume, I should maybe point out that I have not played any games with this deck. I have never played in a pod with a Stax deck. This is all kind of abstract, theoretical, gold fishing by myself in Cockatrice. So, yeah, again, leave comments and help me make this deck better. Help me get better at Magic and help me get better at understanding what makes Stax so good and so brutal. But I think for a first attempt, it's not too bad. I'll let you be the judge in a minute. There are four removal effects, Assassin's Trophy. My goodness, every time I look at this card, I'm just like, that's really good. Assassin's Trophy is really good. Remarkably good. Probably now the best removal spell. Single target removal spell in Commander. Probably. I don't know what could possibly be better than that. So, and that's the deck. That is the whole deck. We're going to goldfish it right now. Leave a comment below with what you think, or send me an email, danbrownuniverse@gmail.com. Also, feel free to leave a comment with any sort of deck building idea that you may have that you think would make for an interesting episode of WOMBOSTORM. Okay, let's goldfish. All right, let's see how my first ever attempt at building a Stax/Prison deck does it. Let's shuffle, draw my opening hand, take a peek here. We have one land. It's a Dust Bowl, which does not create mana of any particular color. If it were a forest, for example, this would be a pretty strong opening hand, what with my Elvish Mystic and Llanowar Elves, but I just think that's too risky. I'm going to take, let's say we get a free mulligan. Mulligan, draw an extra card. Okay, still not enough lands to make it worth our while. Go down to six. Okay, that looks like a pretty keepable opening hand. At a glance, I'll scry one. Take a peek at an Awakening Zone. We will, keep it there, because basically all we care about at this point is that the top card is not a land, because we have plenty of mana, it seems. We'll draw for turn one, main phase, drop a forest, and actually won't do the Soul Ring, we'll do the Llanowar Elf so that we get that whole Summoning Sickness thing out of the way. We'll go to turn two, untap, we will draw a land. Okay, that's, it's fine to draw a land, we'll play a Soul Ring, we'll get that Bloodstained Mire in play, and then we'll say for 1, 2, 3, I will also sacrifice this forest to say, hero, it shall cost sack of land, search my library for up to 2 basic lands, and put them on the battlefield. Doesn't say tapped, so we'll do FNF3 like that. We will snag, let's go ahead and grab a forest back, and then we'll grab a, a mountain. Yeah, let's grab a mountain also. And then while we're at it, we'll go ahead and crack this Bloodstained Mire -1 life, who cares? Do we want Badlands? Is that what we want? Black, yeah, I think that probably is what we want. So we'll snag that Badlands. And then for 1, 2, 3, drop that Awakening Zone, right? I did that, right? Like, Hero, yeah, they come into play. They put them on the battlefield. It doesn't say tapped, so they're untapped. So I can do all that. It's just, this is an amazing board presence for turn two. Not that we have many cards in hand, we're going to be top decking, but let's just see. We'll turn three, upkeep trigger on the Awakening Zone. We'll make an Eldrazi spawn, another potential mana draw, another mana, and then we'll play a Llanowar Waste. And what does that leave us? We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 mana potentially. Well, so definitely what we're doing is dropping Darigaaz and bringing the beats to someone during combat. Okay, we'll end our turn. Move to turn four, untap, upkeep. We'll create another Eldrazi spawn. We will draw. Don't you love Stax? Doesn't this feel like a Stax game? Drew a land. That's nothing. I will play a land. We will continue to bring the beats. We will move to turn five. We will untap during our upkeep. We'll get another Eldrazi spawn. We will draw. That's pretty juicy right about now. Move to our main phase. 2 mana from Soul Ring. Skull Clamp comes into play. We have 1 mana floating. We will equip an Eldrazi spawn. And we will draw. Okay. Thinky. Thorn of Amethyst and Bitter Blossom. It is turn 5, which means that our opponents have probably started doing mid-rangey type plays, although we might reasonably assume, given the start that we had, that we are in pole position. So the Thorn of Amethyst strikes me as probably a strong move. The only reservation I have is if any sort of mass land destruction effect we draw into might also destroy artifacts and potentially enchantments, although I think that most of them leave enchantments alone, so Bitter Blossom should be okay. And we definitely don't want to cast the Thorn of Amethyst right away. I think that we go ahead and just, you know, let's nuke another Eldrazi spawn to the Skull Clamp and see what other cards we get. Okay, and we got a Mastermind's Acquisition, which is going to fetch us up anything that we might want. So let's see. We still have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 mana potentially this turn. And yeah, we do have 2 black sources, so we can get this Mastermind's Acquisition going. We'll probably stop the Skull Clamp shenanigans right there. We'll start combat. We'll poke someone with Darigaaz. We'll go to our second main phase. And yeah, we'll say black, 3, 4, like that. Cast Mastermind's Acquisition, search our library for a card, and then put it into our hand. FM3, take a peek. It's going to be something that blows up everything, but the question is, what is the best way to blow up everything? We can cycle Decree of Annihilation to destroy all lands, which would be uncounterable and would still leave us with Llanowar Elves and Sol Ring and everything else that we have. We will have... Okay, it's going to glitch out. I have to close out of this for a second. So next turn, I mean, without our lands... Let's see. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 mana, including the Awakening Zone token. So that means 7, which means we have 2 left to then drop the Thorn of Amethyst, which seems... pretty good. We don't want to drop that just yet. But so, yeah, I think that I probably will get the Decree of Annihilation, because cycling to destroy all lands means it cannot be counterspelled. So let's see. Anything else with turn 5? I have 2 mana up, and none of it is black, so I can't just drop that Bitter Blossom. I think we'll go ahead and just move to turn 6. I forget if I played I probably already played a land. But just in case I didn't, I want to say that so that no one leaves a comment like, you're stupid. You can leave a comment that says I'm stupid. I don't care. But draw for turn. Sulphurous Springs. Main phase. We will go with... get that out there. Yeah, Sulphurous Springs. Let's do a little bit of board maintenance real quick. Get those multicolored lands. Hold on. I probably don't want to drop that Sulphurous Springs right now. I'm going to destroy all lands. So hold on. Takesies, backsies. Yeah, we're gold fishing. Gold fishing is the right time for takesies, backsies. All right. Quick assessment. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 mana available to us. So this would be 7, and then that's enough to also drop the Thorn of Amethyst and or Bitter Blossom, although the Thorn of Amethyst seems juicy given what we're about to do to people. So... yeah, I'd say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, like that. That's fine. Cycle a Decree of Pain to destroy all lands. All lands go into the graveyard, and we will draw a card. Boom, boom, boom. Drew into another mass land destruction effect. Ho-hum. All right, and then for 2 mana, go and get that Thorn of Amethyst out there, and then swing in with the Darigaaz Beats. Wow, this is shaping up into a pretty interesting, fun game for our opponents. Turn 7. It will untap, upkeep, get an Awakening Zone trigger, get that Eldrazi spawn out there. We will draw a card. It's Destructive Flow. Yes. Will we have the mana, though? I don't think I have mana, and I certainly don't have the mana considering that non-creature spells cost 1 more to cast. What we can do, however, is get that Sulphurous Springs into play, and then for 1, 2, 3... drop that Bitter Blossom, okay, and then we'll be really churning out some tokens, which we could feed into the Skull Clamp if we want to. We could even do that right now with this Eldrazi spawn. I think why not put that Eldrazi spawn on that Skull Clamp to draw. Got a Winter Orb there, seems like a lot of fun. We'll move to combat. We'll poke someone with Darigaaz. Move to turn 8. We will untap. This will probably be the last turn that I goldfish, just because you already see and can understand how the deck's supposed to function. Draw an Azusa, which will be very great for continuing to rebuild, 1, 2, 3. Drop that Azusa, does not cost 2 more because it is not a non-creature, which is to say it is a creature. Then we'll drop that mountain into play, and then we'll get that Dust Bowl into play, and then we'll get this Carpluzan Forest into play as our third land drop for turn. Maybe that's my four. Maybe did I play that forest? I don't remember. I'm not paying enough attention. But anyway, you see how this is going. I play that Winter Orb, you know, really lock things down. Can't untap your lands, but that's okay. Yeah, we're starting to grind. We can sacrifice the Eldrazi spawn to the Skull Clamp to draw 2 more cards, and we've got a Static Orb in there, and we're locking stuff down, get that Destructive Flow eventually. We blow up lands if we have to, draw more cards, even though the quicker way to draw cards is going to be a Skull Clamp to draw for. Yeah, you see what's going on? You see how this deck works? You see how stacks might be an effective strategy? Effective, sure. But when you consider that the real game is the metagame and the real win condition is having the most fun. Well, I guess I might need to rethink my slogan, my catchphrase, in light of Stax and my knowledge, my newfound knowledge of this strategy, because if the real win condition is having the most fun, I mean, we are the only player having fun right now because our opponents are presumably locked out of their of their boards and their decks entirely. So we have really won, because we're the only ones having any amount of fun. Although, if your friends aren't having fun and you lose your friends, did you really, in the long run, in hindsight, have that much fun? You lost out on net fun because of friends that maybe don't want to play with you anymore, because this is the sort of deck you keep bringing to Commander Night, forcing this weird little Cold War arms race sort of thing between you and all your playing group. All right, remember, folks. Your mother wants to hear from you, so give her a call. Thank you very much for watching. Like, comment, subscribe!